Hello everyone. Welcome to Living Hope Church Online, brought to you by Living Hope Church Broadcast Media. I am your host, Pastor Dr. Kemi Atunda Ilori, the General Overseer of Living Hope Church. Today, Sunday, the 28th of August 2022, I'm really grateful to God that I have the opportunity to conclude our series on divine intervention. Divine intervention. The topic today is the certainty of divine intervention. The certainty of divine intervention. Firstly, please come with me to the scripture that underpins the whole series. You will find this in Job chapter 8, verses 20 to 22. Job chapter 8, verses 20 to 22. Behold, God will not cast away the blameless, nor will he uphold the evildoers. God will yet fill your mouth with laughing and your lips with rejoicing. Those who hate you will be clothed with shame, and the dwelling place of the wicked will come to nothing. These are splendid promises of God for us. And these scriptures generate the theme for the month of August in Living Hope Church. The theme that we have been concentrating on throughout this month, the theme of divine intervention. There are certain scriptures that I would have loved to read on this broadcast, but it's best for you to dig into those scriptures in your own time. Let me just mention them right now. Exodus chapter 14, verses 15 to 29. In that particular account, we meet the Lord God Almighty fighting for the children of Israel. And this was acknowledged even by Pharaoh and his armies, that God was fighting for Israel. So the Egyptians had to run away from the battle. Not only that, the children of Israel, they crossed the Red Sea on dry land. This was an obstacle that God turned into a miracle for them, because God intervened in their situation. And when the Egyptians tried to cross the Red Sea in pursuit of the children of Israel, God brought back the Red Sea, and the sea covered all the chariots, all the armies of the Egyptian Pharaoh. So God intervened. Divine intervention is certain. In Zechariah chapter 2, verses 1 to 13, you will read how God makes promises to the children of Israel. They did not have to fast or pray or beg. God simply made these promises out of the abundance of his love for them. Divine intervention is certain. So God referred to the children of Israel as the apple of his eyes. And God says, whoever touches you, they touch the apple of my eyes. It's important for us to know that similarly in Christ Jesus, when we are walking in the salvation that Jesus brought on the basis of his sinless life, on the basis of his death on the cross, on the basis of the blood which he shed to atone for our sins, so that through him we could be reconciled to God. When we are walking in that salvation, we are the apple of God's eye. Those who touch us, they touch him. Otherwise, how would you explain that wonderful scripture that says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would put their faith in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." It is because through Jesus Christ, we are the apple of God's eye. Anyone who touches us, they are touching the apple of God's eye. There will certainly be divine intervention. In Psalms 105, verses 1 to 15, there is a recount of the many acts of divine intervention that God worked out in the history of the children of Israel. And one of the famous verses that we all know runs like this: "Do not harm my prophets. Do not touch my anointed ones." I know sometimes people want to think that the anointed ones are preachers, are church leaders, are the so-called men and women of God. But actually, when you have Jesus in your life, you are one of the anointed ones. It is Jesus in my life that makes me anointed, not the title general overseer. No matter the fanciful title that anyone might call themselves, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, no matter what they might call themselves, those titles do not give them any anointing. What gives us anointing is our relationship with Jesus. It's the fact that we have the Holy Spirit dwelling in our heart, dwelling in our homes. The anointing comes from the Holy Spirit, not from any title. So if you are born again, you can only be born again by the Holy Spirit of God. So if that has happened in your life, Psalm 105 verses 1 to 15 will also be true for you. When the Lord says, "Touch not my anointed, do not do my prophets any harm," you are that person. I am that person. Divine intervention is certain. Isaiah chapter 41 verses 1 to 14. In Isaiah chapter 41 verses 1 to 14, the Lord was speaking to the children of Israel, confirming to them how much he cares for them, how much he loves them. The Lord says in verse 10, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." In verse 11, Isaiah chapter 41, "Behold, all those who are incensed or angry against you shall be ashamed and disgraced. They shall be as nothing, and those who strive with you shall perish. You shall seek them and not find them, those who contended with you. Those who war against you shall be as nothing, as a non-existent thing." From all the scriptures we have read, you can see why the topic today is divine intervention is certain. The certainty of divine intervention. The technical word that we should use is actually the word certitude. the certitude of divine intervention that it will definitely happen. If you are in this kind of relationship with God, you can be sure it will definitely happen. So, divine intervention is always going on in the background of every life because God is constantly working in His creation. God is constantly at work in His creation. In John chapter 5, verse 17, Jesus says, "My Father has been working until now, and I have been working." So you might read in the book of Genesis that God rested on the seventh day. It doesn't mean that God never does anything again. Actually, in the background of every life, whether people believe in God or not, whether they pray or not, divine intervention is going on. Divine intervention is about the relationship of God to us and our relationship to God. Think of it this way. If we take divine intervention as an elastic, flexible string, rope, or cord, divine intervention has two ends. Think of a rope. One end is with God, and the other end is with us. You can't say, "I'm going to drop the rope." You can't escape from divine intervention. Whether people believe in God or not, whether they are Christian or not, it doesn't matter. There is divine intervention going on because God is constantly at work in His creation. So let us explain it in a different way. Whether humans know God or not, there will always be divine intervention, either in their favor as a divine blessing or against them as divine judgment. So when you look at the story of the children of Israel and Pharaoh, divine intervention occurred as a favor, divine favor for Israel, but as a kind of judgment, utter judgment on Pharaoh and all his armies. And that's the way it is. Every time that you see, that you hear, that you witness an act of divine intervention, it's either one of favor towards one person, one nation, one group, one community, and judgment against another person, a community, a group, a nation. So divine intervention is a certainty, and it is based on our relationship with God. It is about God's sovereignty and human freedom. All of us, we will do whatever our heart dictates. All of us, we will do whatever we want to do, but we can't escape the sovereignty of God. We are free to do whatever we think we want to do, but we can never escape the sovereignty of God. Whatever we choose to do, whatever we plan to do, can only be possible if God permits it. So the sovereignty of God and human freedom, both of them are joined together mysteriously. Amen. Amen. There is one question that is at the top of my mind as we conclude the series on divine intervention. Remember, the topic today is the certainty of divine intervention. So the question at the top of my mind is, if this is the case, what should be your attitude in relation to divine intervention? If this is the case, that divine intervention is certain. What are the implications for me? What are the implications for you? How would you apply divine intervention in your relationship with God, in your relationship with other people, whether in your family or in your community or in your workplace or wherever you locate yourself? If divine intervention is as the Bible teaches us, which I've just explained, what are the implications for your own relationship with God? How do you apply divine intervention in your relationship with other people? Okay, that's fine. Let me show us 3 points that have helped me immensely in enjoying divine intervention. 3 applications that have enabled me, against all the odds, to enjoy divine intervention. Application number 1. Divine intervention always follows the shape of our relationship with God. Divine intervention always follows the shape of our relationship with God. Put it this way, most times human relationships are actually unstable. Most times. That's why you can say to yourself, there are people that you have loved and who have loved you that in good season you will think they would never leave you, but they have left you. And other people can say the same thing about you, that maybe there was a time they would think that you would never leave them, but you have left them. The fact is, human relationships basically are unstable. That's why you see that people can get married and make a vow that they will be with each other for the rest of their life, but the scale of divorce is only getting higher and higher. Now, we can give many reasons why marriage fails, but one important reason anyway is that human relationships basically are unstable for a variety of reasons. You just think of how many people have walked away from you and how many you have left too, for good or for ill, for whatever reasons. So in its most basic form, despite its essential nature, human relationship can be described as watery. Human relationships can be described as watery. Let me explain it a bit further. Water can occur in 3 states. It can occur in a solid state as ice, when it is very cold and it becomes solid as ice. Water can also be liquid and wet and flow, especially in the path of least resistance. And then, of course, weather can have a third shape or a third form. Weather can be gas, it can vaporize, it can just disappear as steam into the environment. Those are the 3 shapes of water. When you look at human relationship, basically, the nature of it, humanly speaking, is that it is watery. When the times are good, human relationship flows so nicely. It is so essential. It is life-giving. But when times are bad, human relationship can turn into a cold thing. There is no affection, no love again. And in the third type of the shape of water, You might wake up being nice and being kind to somebody, and then suddenly during the day, it all changes. It has all vanished. It has turned into vapor and gone. The relationship has ended. Because of the nature of Adamic sin, that is the basic nature of every human relationship. And most of the time, that is the kind of relationship that we have with God. Watery, unreliable, unstable. But you see, God does not want our relationship with Him to be watery. God does not want our relationship with Him to be watery. So what's important for us, especially when the Holy Spirit is in our life, is that we begin to move away from the watery nature of human relationship. It begins to develop into something that is durable, something that is strong, something that is unbreakable, something that is, in spite of it all, is ductile. It can be molded as time goes on into even a better illustration of what it means to love, to care. The Holy Spirit is the one who helps us to move away from a watery state of relationship with God to a solid state of relationship with God. That solid state, you can describe it as steel. Steel. God wants our relationship with Him to be as solid as steel, to be as strong as steel. The physical properties of steel include high strength, durability, ductility, and corrosion resistance. Steel offers great strength, even though it is light in weight. Steel is durable. Steel is malleable. It can be easily molded to form any desired or desirable shape. God wants our relationship with Him to be as strong, durable, consistent, reliable as steel. It's the same thing that we should practice in our relationship with one another. Husband to wife, wife to husband, parents to children, children to parents. It has to be intentional. We have to intentionally create relationships that are durable, relationships that are corrosion resistant, that will resist corrosion, that will resist compromise, that in the face of every odd, in the face of every obstacle, the relationship will stand. That is what God is expecting from us. That is the kind of relationship that the Holy Spirit is nurturing in us. So I really want to encourage us. See, divine intervention always follows the shape of our relationship with God. Therefore, invest your time, invest your resources, invest your mental energies, invest your whole being in allowing the Holy Spirit to nurture your relationship with God, so that your relationship with God is as strong as steel. Because divine intervention will always follow the shape of your relationship with God. With your relationship with God growing stronger and stronger, divine intervention will always be in your favor. And those who attack you, divine intervention will be against them. It will be a judgment against them. It's so important as we close on the series of teaching on divine intervention, for me to stress this important application. Divine intervention always follows the shape of our relationship with God. Check your relationship with God. Be where God wants you to be, doing what God wants you to do. Do not be a fair weather friend with God. A lot of people, they are only coming to God on the basis of their belly, their mental needs, their physical needs, their emotional needs. They are like the people that Jesus told in the Bible, "You are seeking me only because of what you want to eat and drink, only because of the bread, not because I am your savior, not because of eternal life." And I really want to challenge us. A lot of people have come to church, but they have not yet come to Christ. I know what it means, because that happened in my life as well. But God in His mercy touched my life, made me to realize that the shape of my relationship is important to Him. And by the grace of God, I accepted the salvation that is found in Jesus Christ. In His mercy, God poured His Holy Spirit into my life, into my heart. And now, because of the Holy Spirit, I'm growing day by day. My relationship with God has moved away from the Adamic nature of watery human relationships. My relationship with God has now moved into the grade of Holy Spirit directed relationship with God, Holy Spirit nurtured. Remember, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God. May God in His mercy make this even more plain to you. May God grant you the practical experience of what it means to have your relationship growing solid as steel, rather than your relationship being as watery as water. Remember this first point. Divine intervention will follow the shape of your relationship with God. Let's go to application number two. You see, when you know that your relationship is growing as steel, it is not watery as water, your relationship with God is growing. And it is something you will see in how you handle life, in how you treat people, in how you love people selflessly, generously, caringly. No duplicity, no fakeness, no hypocrisy, no malice, no envy, no causeless hatred. You see, when your relationship is growing as steel rather than as watery water with God, this second application will also be present. What is the second application? You will come to a certain point in your life where you know that one with God is always a majority. What does that mean? You will always seek to please God rather than men. That is the second application. Divine intervention always follows the shape of our relationship with God. And as that relationship grows, you will know that it is God that you must please in all that you do. If I love you, I must love you because of God. If you love me, you must love me because of God. You want to please God, not men. You are not looking for somebody to reward you for serving God. You are not going about begging for money, begging for this, begging for that, in order to serve God. You are not doing that. Amen. Amen. As your relationship grows, whatever you have, God has given it to you so that you use it to please Him. Your time, your skills, your talents, your money. And don't let anybody say, oh, I don't have any money. Your money. Everything that you possess, the entirety of your life, once you begin to use your life to serve God, it will be very clear to you that one with God is a majority. You will be using your life to please God rather than man. Let me give you three examples. Let me give us three examples of people who are men pleasers. Because naturally, all of us, until we begin to surrender our life to the Holy Spirit, we are just men pleasers. We are men pleasers. I remember on Facebook, when I look at the number of friends, over 4,000 friends, a lot of us, that is something to clap for. That is something to cherish. But of course, Facebook friends doesn't really count with God. A lot of us, when we have a particular social event, we would like the whole village, the whole city to attend. We want to be friends with multitudes. And a lot of us, we have been schooled and trained that when your church is full and bursting with people, that's when it shows that you are growing. So you can see, ordinarily, our Adamic nature is to please people. Our Adamic nature is to find people praising us. That's our Adamic nature. But guess what? When you begin to really invest your life in God, it will come to you for certainty that you must please God rather than men. That all your life, it must be about pleasing God rather than men. See, for example, a person like Aaron. In Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 to 8, in order to please the crowd, he fashioned a golden calf and said to the children of Israel, "Here is the calf that brought you out of Egypt." He became an idol worshiper. What a shame. But that's what happens to us when we are people pleasers. We become idolaters. We worship people. We worship them. We put them higher than God. It's important for us to know the distinction between respecting and honoring people and worshiping them. It's so important. I must know the distinction between honoring and respecting my wife, honoring and respecting members of Living Hope Church, honoring and respecting people that God has brought into my life. Every day God brings people into our life. It's good to know the difference between honoring and respecting them and turning them into idols and worshiping them and making them little gods. May God in His mercy help us. Aaron began to say to the children of Israel, it wasn't God the Almighty who brought them through the Red Sea. It was the golden calf that he had fashioned, and some demonic spirit is now attached to, and the people are eager to worship it. This happens in life. It happens in many church congregations, and it seems the larger the crowd, the larger the multitude, the more likely you are going to get people who are worshiping idols rather than God, who please people rather than they please God. Another example that we find in the Bible is Saul, the first king of Israel. You'll see the story in 1 Samuel chapter 13, verses 11 to 13. In fact, twice Saul showed that he wanted to please people rather than God. So in the first instance, in 1 Samuel chapter 13, verses 11 to 13, Saul himself confessed to Samuel the prophet, "When I saw people departing from me, I felt compelled to offer sacrifice that I was not meant to offer in order to please them so that they can stay with me." A lot of people, they are offering sacrifices that God doesn't approve. They are making sacrifices that God doesn't approve. Because they are making those sacrifices in order to attract the attention of men and women, in order to please men and women. People are spending their money on so-called church leaders, you know, so-called men and women of God, in a way that shows that they think they are spending their money for God, but they are wasting it because they are trying to please men rather than to please God. May God in His mercy help each one of us to know the distinction between sowing generously into God's purposes and simply sowing vainly into a person's agenda for bigness, for personal celebrity status, for personal progress and personal advancement, for personal wealth and riches. Because a lot of people, that is where they are in their church life. They are yet to be in Christ. They are in the church, but they are not yet in Christ. But even outside of church, a lot of people are making sacrifices that God does not require of them. They are making those sacrifices in order to please men and women, sometimes out of fear of being alone, of being excluded, sometimes out of peer pressure, sometimes because of the custom that they are brought up in, because of the culture of their people. They are pleasing men, pleasing traditions, but they are not pleasing God. Listen, this is a very simple but very profound matter. Divine intervention. The second application is that you come to a place in your heart that you are a God pleaser rather than a man pleaser. So you find the example in Saul. Saul did the same thing. When God asked him to go and have a war with the Amalekites, God gave him clear instructions. And then he came back in 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 24, that because of the people, he spared Agag. Because of the people, he allowed the people to get some spoils, to take some booty from the war with the Amalekites. When God had told him, no booty must be taken, no spoil must be taken, everything must be destroyed. Don't be a people pleaser. Divine intervention will not work for you as you might want it to work for you. Look at a third example. When you read about Pontius Pilate in John chapter 18, verse 28 to John chapter 19, verse 22, Pontius Pilate, you see, he knew Jesus was innocent, but in order to please the crowd, he released Barabbas, and then he had Jesus scourged, and he had Jesus crucified. Then he brought water out and said, "I'm washing my hands." Look at the hypocrisy. When people are like that, when you are a people pleaser, when you love the applause of the crowd, when all you want to do is to make sure that people are on your side by all means, guess what? You will be a hypocrite. You won't stand on the side of God. You will know somebody is innocent and yet you will be against them. You know somebody is a good person in your life and yet you will be against them. You will rather side with those who are malicious, those who are envious, those who are an enemy of somebody that you know to be gracious and kind. We are saying this very clearly. The second application of divine intervention is that you will know that one with God is a majority. One with God is a majority. Come with me to Acts chapter 5, verse 29. Acts chapter 5, verse 29. Peter and the other apostles answered and said, "We ought to obey God rather than men." Did you notice that throughout their life, divine intervention occurred regularly as acts of God's sovereignty in greatness, in mercy? Galatians chapter 1, verse 10. Does this sound as if I am trying to win human approval? No, indeed. What I want is God's approval. Am I trying to be popular with people? If I were still trying to do so, I would not be a servant of Christ. Can you see why divine intervention worked so regularly in the life of Paul? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4, this is what Paul wrote. "For we speak as messengers approved by God to be entrusted with the good news. Our purpose is to please God, not people. It is God alone who examines the motives of our hearts." May God in His mercy help each one of us to understand this second application of divine intervention, that you know that you know that in your life, one with God is more than a majority, that you exist only to please God, only to do His will, only to obey Him. Amen. And how do you do that? God says, love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself, or love people selflessly. May God in His mercy fill our heart through His Holy Spirit with that desire to please Him in all that we do, in all that we think, in all that we say. Time is far past. So let us come to the third point where we are going to finish. The third application of divine intervention. Divine intervention will teach you that all things work together for your good. Amen. All things work together for your good. Look at all the stories relating to the life of Joseph. Everything that people did to stop him from becoming what God had already promised him, everything that people did against him only helped Joseph to get to where God was taking him. That is the story of my life too. That is the story of Living Hope Church. Why? Because divine intervention is certain. Everything will work together for your good. That's why you'll be a person that is calm, cool, composed. You are not under panic. You are not under pressure. You are just so reassured that God is working in the background of your life to achieve the very best for you. Amen. So, as I usually say, throw me up, dash me down, I will win. How? God will win through for me. God will always intervene to ensure that He protects His interest in my life. Remember when we started, He says, "You are the apple of my eye. Those who touch you, they touch me." He says, do not harm my prophet. Do not touch my anointed. God makes promises extravagantly for Jerusalem, for the people of Israel. We are in the same kind of covenant relationship with God when we are in Christ Jesus. We are not talking about those who just go to church and they are always running helter-skelter, looking for that prophet, this one, that one. Their life is not settled in Christ. They do not understand that divine intervention is certain to happen. They have nothing to fear. They can trust God because God, through Christ Jesus, is in their life. The one who is in their heart is greater than the one who is in the world. This third application is extremely important if you are going to be a very calm, a very cool, a very composed person, no matter what you are going through in life. If you are going to come to a certain knowledge that you will say, I know that I know all things work together for my good. Why? Because I just know in the background of my life, divine intervention is working. Amen. So let's finish. Romans chapter 8, verses 28 to 30. This is where we conclude today. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to God's purpose. For whom God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that his Son might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom God predestined, this he also called. Whom he called, this he also justified. And whom he justified, this he also glorified. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. Remember the three applications of divine intervention. May God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit bless you. Until another broadcast on Living Hope Church Online, I am your host, Pastor Dr. Kemi Atanda Ilori, the General Overseer of Living Hope Church. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you for watching this broadcast. Thank you. And bye for now.